Good morning, students. Today we will cover the chapter The Russian Revolution. The Russian Revolution, it is the collective term for the series of revolutions in Russia in 1905 to 1917, which destroyed the Tsarist autocracy and led to the creation of the Soviet Union. Now, there were few groups in Russia who inspired in its early stages. Let's talk about those groups. These were the liberals, the radicals, and the conservatives. The liberals. These were one of the group which looked to change the society. Liberals wanted a nation which tolerated all religions. They also opposed uncontrolled power of dynastic rulers. On the other hand, the radicals, they wanted a nation in which government was based on the majority of a country's population. They even supported women's suffrage movement, and they opposed the privileges of great landowners and wealthy factory owners. The third group was of the conservatives. These conservatives were opposed to radicals and the liberals. They believed that the past had to be respected and change had to be brought about through a slow process. Many early socialist thinkers were also there who inspired the people or who inspired this revolution. One was Robert Owen. He was a leading English manufacturer who believed in the idea of cooperatives. He sought to build a cooperative community called New Harmony in Indiana. Louis Blanc, he was a French thinker who wanted the government to encourage cooperatives and replace capitalist enterprises. These cooperatives were the association of the people who produced goods together and divided the profits according to the work done by the members. Then was a Karl Marx. He believed that to free themselves from capitalist exploitation, workers had to construct a radically socialist society where all property was socially controlled, and this would be a communist society. The book written by Karl Marx, that is the Das Kapital, it has become very famous, and the communists normally follow this book. Now, before we proceed, I would like to tell you about some differences of this capitalism and the socialism. What is a capitalism? It is the individuals and the business who own property, and they also own the means of production. Whereas the socialism or the socialists, they put forward the idea that the community or the state should own property and the means of production. As far as capitalism is concerned, their main motive is the profit making, whereas in socialism, it is the welfare of the workers and the peasants. They believe that capitalist employers, they take advantage of the workers. The community or state must act to protect the workers. So both these forms, they were totally opposite of each other. And socialism was very much prevalent in Russia. And we can say that it became a major cause or major force behind the revolution. What was a pre-revolutionary Russia? That Tsar Nicholas II, he was ruling over Russia. He was an absolute king. The government was not at all a democratic one. And the autocracy was being followed in Russia. Now we'll talk about the revolution of 1905, where the workers demanded the peace. They wanted their land to cultivate and the bread or the food. One very major event took place in 1905, which started a series of events that were known as the 1905 revolution. this year had a it was a very bad one for the Russian workers. The prices of essential goods rose so quickly that the real wages had declined by 20%, and the membership of the workers association also rose dramatically. And what happened that when four members of the Assembly of Russian Workers were dismissed at the Petrolov Iron Works, there was a call for industrial action. Now, these workers, they led the procession and they reached the Winter Palace, but they were attacked by the police. And in this incident, over 100 workers were killed and about 300 were wounded. The incident, it was known as the Bloody Sunday, and it started a series of events that became to be known as the 1905 revolution. Now, during this revolution, what Tsar did that he allowed the creation of an elected consultative parliament or the Duma, but he suspended the Duma twice, and the third time he packed the Duma with conservative politicians, and the liberals and revolutionaries were kept out because he wanted his rule to be unquestioned. And basically he ignored the welfare of the people. Now, one more reason behind this revolution was Alexandra. Alexandra, she was the wife of Tsar Nicholas II. She was very much under the influence of a monk named Rasputin. There had been a reason behind this, that Alexis, who was the son of Alexandra and Tsar, he was suffering from hemophilia. And Alexandra believed that Rasputin has the power to heal him. But the monk, Rasputin, he was a very corrupt one, and the scandals around Rasputin discredited Tsar. Meantime, World War I had started in 1914, which broke Russia's economy, and Tsar also did not bother much about the sufferings of the people. This war had killed thousands of the people, and the people were also very upset with the rule of Tsar. Meantime, these Alexandra and Rasputin, they threw the government into chaos, and the people were so much upset with this type of imperial government. So now there was a collapse in the government. Now, it was the year 1917. There had been two revolutions which are collectively known as the Revolution of 1917. First one was the February Revolution. What happened in February? That on 22nd February, a lockout took place at a factory on the right bank of the Neva River. And on the next day, workers in 50 factories went on strike to show their solidarity. Even the women, they led the way to strikes in many factories. And the demonstrators, they crossed from the factory quarters to the center of the capital. The movement was not being actively organized by any political party. The government imposed a curfew and the demonstrators dispersed by the evening, but they came back on 24th and 25th. Cavalry and police were called to keep a watch on the demonstrators. Now, the government, it suspended the Duma on 25th February. Demonstrators, they returned to larger number to the streets of the left bank on 26th February. The police headquarters were ransacked on 27th February. Now, the government once again called out the cavalry to control the situation, but the cavalry refused to fire on the demonstrators. An officer of a regiment was shot at, and three other regiments mutinied to join the striking workers. By the evening of 27th February, soldiers and striking workers gathered to form a Soviet or council in the same building as the Duma met. This was the Petrograd Soviet, and a delegation went to see the Tsar on 20th February. The Tsar abdicated on 2nd March on the advice of the military, and a provisional government was formed by the Soviet leaders and the Duma leaders. Thus, the February Revolution of 1970 brought down the monarchy in Russia. So this February Revolution, the basic consequence was that the monarchy was abolished in Russia and provisional government was formed by the Soviet leaders. Now what happened in October Revolution? We will first discuss what happened after the February 1, that the Lenin, he had been a very, you can say he was a communist leader, he was a very great leader of Russia, and he had been exiled. In April 1917, he was a Bolshevik leader and he returned to Russia from his exile. He and the other Bolsheviks, they had opposed the war since 1914. So when Vladimir Lenin, he returned from the exile, he put forward his three demands, which are known as Lenin's April thesis. The demands were that he declared that the war be brought to a close. Secondly, land be transferred to the peasants. And thirdly, banks be nationalized. So these three demands, these are known as Lenin's April thesis. He also argued that the Bolshevik Party should rename itself the Communist Party to indicate its new radical aims. This Lenin and this provisional government, which was formed after the February Revolution, they were the regular conflicts between both the provisional government and the Bolsheviks. So as these conflicts grew, Lenin feared that the provisional government would set up a dictatorship. So now he was planning for a socialist seizure of power. So on 16th October 1917, Lenin persuaded the Petrograd Soviet and the Bolshevik Party to agree to a socialist seizure of power. And for this purpose, a military revolutionary committee was appointed by the Soviet under Trotsky to organize the seizure. And it was followed by few of the events. And by December, the Bolsheviks controlled the Moscow Petrograd area. So this was exactly the October Revolution, where now the provisional government was also abolished and the rule of Bolsheviks was there in Russia. Now after having the power, or after being in power, what the Lenin did, that he accepted the peace treaty, and that ended the World War I with Germany. And in 1919 and 1920, what happened? That white armies, what was the white armies? It were the pro-Tsarist army and the Menshevik. Both these troops, they attacked the Bolsheviks from all the directions, but these Bolsheviks proved to be a winner one, and they defeated the white army. Now, what was the rule of Lenin? He ruled from 1920 till 1924. And he worked a lot for Russia. His economic reforms included the new economic plan, which was a moderate mixture of capitalism and socialism. As far as his political reforms are concerned, these are Bolshevik Party, it became the Communist Party. And Russia became the United Soviet Socialist Republic. Now it was the year 1924. Lenin died. And there was a power vacuum there in Russia. Now there were two major or very important people were there. Leon Trotsky, who was appointed by the Soviets so as to have a socialist seizure of power there by Lenin. So he had been, he was having a very prominent position in Russia, and the other was Joseph Stalin. And in the fight of power between Trotsky and Stalin, Stalin took over the took the control of Russia. And firstly, he decided when he had the power, so he decided to create a totalitarian state. What is a totalitarian state? We'll talk about totalitarian state, which was there under Stalin. Totalitarian state means a government that takes total central state control over every aspect of public and private life. What was Stalin's totalitarian state? It had taken control of state control of economy, police, religion, and even the means of propaganda and the education. We will talk about all these things one by one. Control methods. Campaign of terror was there against enemies who threatened his power, and these people, whosoever went against Stalin's policies, they were sent to the death camps. An estimated 8 to 13 million people were killed in these death camps by Stalin's government. You can see in this picture that how brutally the people were killed. Now, the means of propaganda, these all were controlled by Stalin's government. All newspapers, radio, movies, informations, and only the Stalin and its communism was glorified through these newspapers, radios, and other means of propaganda. As far as religion is concerned, he replaced Orthodox teachings with communist teachings and destroyed the churches and all the areas which were meant for the religious gatherings. His industrial policies said that government makes all the economic decisions. So all the economic decisions were now there under the control of the government. 5-year plans were made. High quotas or high goals were there for the output of steel, coal, oil and electricity. And there was a very less production of the food grains, or the very less consumer production was there. So what was the result? That the people faced shortages of housing, food, clothing and other goods. So no doubt industrial gain was there, but still the people, they were not getting the consumer goods. His agricultural policy, he worked on the collective farms, which was known as the collectivization policy of Stalin. Under this, what he did, that the peasants were forced to cultivate in the collective farms, which were known as the kolkhoz, and he believed, he hoped that it will boost the food production. But it did not work, and the wealthy farm owners, they resisted. And the situation still persisted, and the food shortage could not be, the problem of food shortage could not be solved. As far as education is concerned, he wanted to build a strictly society that adhered to create a much more communist state. Education law of 1935 stated that it allowed teachers to use strict methods of discipline, and the communist history was taught in the schools. But one thing which was good for the girls, that they were allowed in schools. Now, what are the consequences and significance of the Russian Revolution? The international significance is that it struck terror in the minds of the capitalists all over the world, as the revolution made an irresistible appeal to the proletarians. It invited the laboring people all over the world to unite against the capitalist classes. And now there was a war was declared between totalitarian dictatorship and democratic socialism, or you can say between the Marxism and the capitalism. Global Impact says that the character of the nationalist revolutions in the colonial world were given a new social and economic content. Politically, the cult of the common man was a major result of the Soviet democracy. In the economic field, the conception of economic planning and the idea of central direction of the national economy also emerged. E.H. Carr, he declared that if we are all planners now, this is largely the result, conscious or unconscious, of the impact of Soviet practice and Soviet achievement. Further consequences, it divided the world into two diametrically opposite power blocks, one being the communist bloc led by the Soviet Union and the other being the anti-communist bloc under the leadership of the US. The revolution of 1917 transformed a poverty-stricken Tsarist Russia into a superpower under the guiding spirits of Lenin, Stalin and other leaders. So I hope, students, that this chapter is very, very much clear to you people. We have covered all the important aspects.